Hi, this is MC Jetty for the next episode of my new modding tutorial series, where I continue where I left off the last time. So, first, let's start by looking at the code we have here. So, the first thing I want to show you is first block. So, this is a simple block. Let me actually show you what it does in game. By the way, I always run in debug mode. I think it's recommended to do that. If there's a problem, you can set a breakpoint and you can debug things. Okay, so we are in game. First block is this one. So you see I have JAI and I have the one probe. I find it easier to have these in development. So this is the first block of this mod. It is directional and has an inventory. So that's how it looks like. So you see one thing you notice, it will be placed depending on how you look. I will explain how that works later. It also has a user interface, which takes diamonds and converts them to energy. So it consumes a diamond and processes energy. And while it's doing that, you see that the front side is yellow. Also, you see the one probe recognizes the energy and will show it. It uses the capability system for that, which I will explain later. So that's basically what the first block does. So it has a number of functionalities and some uses, and I will explain to you what they do. First block extends block. That's the Minecraft block class that you have to do. In its constructor, it requires a properties block, which indicates some basic properties of this block. It uses the material iron. It also sounds as metal if you walk on it. It has this hardness and this light value, so it produces light. The actual light that it produces depends on this property here. So I will explain that. Add information is about the tooltip that you saw when I hovered over it. And in this example, you see I use translation text component. This is the recommended way to do. It's best not to put hard-coded strings in your source code because they can't be translated. If you do it like this, people can use a language file. And then you can here see message put first block, and then you can see this message that will be shown. There is also a parameter here, so it will can also generate powder at about percent s per tick, and that's you can give that to translation text component. It's recommended to always use strings. I believe that numbers and other things don't work properly. Not sure why that is, but with strings it's always okay. The value that we generate is from the configuration. I will explain that later. So then you have the block state. What's the difference between block and block state? You see here that we use the block state. A block state is an actual representation of the block in the world. Block exists only once. There's only one instance of first block in the game, and every first block that you place in the world will be of that instance. However, the block state might differ if the properties are different. So in our case, what this happens here, when fill state container is a method that you have to override to actually indicate which properties are used for this block. We need two properties. First, we need this one, facing. We could make our own properties, but in this case we're using standard properties. If you control click on this one, you actually browse to this class, which is a part of Minecraft. So it's always useful to be able to browse the Minecraft code. And there you can find a big list of all the properties that they use in their blocks. And if possible, I try to use something standard, something that they have, for example, powered, and the facing that I was using here. So I'm using these two properties. If the block is powered, I return the light value of that is part of the superclass, and this will be 14, otherwise I return 0. Because my block has a tile entity, I return true, and here I create it. So these two methods are important if you have a block that has a tile entity. Be careful, there is also a has tile entity with no parameters, which is deprecated. Don't use that one. Use the one that has the block state parameter. I believe there is also a create tile entity or new tile entity. No, or perhaps there isn't. I'm not sure. But this is the correct version to work in any case. And it just creates the tile entity like this. So what's the difference between a block and a tile entity? A block is limited. It in the world it can only have itself as state and a few properties, in this case powered and facing. But properties have to be enumeratable. You have to be able, there's a finite amount of them. If you want to store an integer like power in our case, you can't store that in a proper in a block state, because that would give too many properties, too many states. That's why there is a tile entity in this case. Tile entities are generally additional information that is associated with the block, like the inventory in energy and so on. You remember that I showed you that when you place this block, it or looks it always is oriented like how you are looking at it. And that's done here. This is a method that you can override that returns the correct block state to use on placement. And it gets a context if you want to look what's inside. Control click. You can see it contains an offset pos, and you can it extends item use context, so you can inspect it to get the player that was doing this, the hand that was being used, the world, the item, ray trace result, so actual position. This way you can get the actual position where the block was targeted, and all this information is given to get state for placement, and from that information you can calculate the correct direction to place. So what do? You get the default state, and you add the property with facing, and you calculate, you can ask from the context the nearest looking direction. This will return the direction that is nearest to where the player is looking. For example, if the player is looking almost at the north side, at the north direction, this will return north. But we want our block to face the opposite way, so that the front is then at the south side. That's why we call the opposite here. If you want to look to work, again, it's important to know where to browse for Minecraft and forge things. If you want to know how this works, you can control click on it, and you can get here, get facing directions, click through, get the values for provided entity looking direction dependent on yaw and pitch of entity looking. Apparently it returns an array. I haven't done this myself. Yeah, first, second, third, get opposite. Apparently it returns an entire array of directions. But we need the first one, because that's the one we're actually looking at, and that's also what this one returns. When our block is activated, we want to open the user interface. So that happens here. A warning, a note about this. Here you get a warning from IntelliJ. It says that this method is deprecated. In this particular case, for blocks and items, being deprecated doesn't mean that you cannot do this. Usually deprecate means that it's a function that you are not supposed to use. And in the case of Minecraft, or at least in this case, it actually means it's okay to overwrite, but you should not call it. It's called automatically by Minecraft, but you should not directly call it. It means you can overwrite, but don't use it yourself. If you want to get rid of the warning, you can disable suppress for method. You can add this one, and the method, it will still put the line. Oh, I suppressed the wrong one. This one, like that. So that's one way that you can suppress this if you don't want to see that. So what do we do? This line is important because we have a container, a GUI, which contains our item, our block state, our tile entity actually contains an item. It has an inventory for the diamonds. And this is stored server-side, this inventory. So we also want to have a GUI that is opened server-side. This may sound a bit strange, but actually when you open a GUI, for example for a chest or a furnace, there's both a server-side component that is being opened, as it were, and the client-side component. The client-side component, of course, knows about the visual things, about how to render the GUI, but the client-side component knows about what are the slots, the items that you want to see, and all that is handled with container. I will explain that more later, but this is why this line is here. World.isRemote is true if you are on the client, because on block activated, many of these methods in blocks and tile entities and items are called on two times, once for the client and once for the server. Here we are interested in the server side, so if not on the client, that means that this code is executed on the server. On the client we do nothing. So what happens here? We open our GUI. I will the container provider I will explain later, but basically we open the GUI on the server side, and this class, which is by the way something from Forge itself, it's something that Forge adds as a convenience. This will make sure that the packet is sent to the client, so that also the GUI opens on the client. You don't have to do that yourself. That's something that's handled by this method. If you have a block or an item that has a GUI that is really only interested in client-side stuff, it doesn't have any items, any slots, it doesn't need to communicate with the server, then you can also open a GUI on the client side. That's also possible, but that's not that common. Usually you want to do it like this. Yeah, that by doing that we explained all the things in this block, but it may still be a bit complex because this is just the block code. Without all those other things it doesn't work. So the second thing that is important here is the tile. So this is tile entity. So as I explained earlier, the tile entity is an object that can hold more stuff for blocks in the world. For example, a chest, a vanilla chest is a tile entity because it needs to store all the items that are in the chest. Same for a furnace or other things like that. In our case, we need a tile entity for two reasons. We also need an inventory for our diamond, and we need the storage. The power storage. In addition to being tile entity, we also implement tickable tile entity because we want our block or tile entity to do something. Every tick, 20 times per second, it should produce power if there are diamonds in its stack. And this interface has one method, which is tick, and that's implemented here. I will explain that in a moment. So, power and items. This is an important subject. You see an example of a supplier again. So power and item handlers are things that are handled in Forge. Forge has capabilities which are a way for inter-mod communication and for dynamically adding capabilities to some object. In our case, we have our tile entity is interested in being able to handle items because we have that slot with one diamond, and we are interested in handling power, Forge energy. These are standard capabilities that you use, but you can also define your own. How do these work? Basically, in your main tile entity class, you always put this construct. You have make a lazy optional, which is a helper class that is capable or of lazy initialization of a specific thing, in this case an item handler. So to do that, you give it a supplier, and that supplier is called as soon as it is needed. Because our supplier actually doesn't create the object, we could have put the create handler here, but we also want to use our items and our energy locally in the tile entity itself, and we don't want to go through the capability system because that's slightly less efficient. So this is a small optimization. This is for internal usage, but for external usage that will go through the capabilities. So it's important to always declare your lazy optionals here, and then later on in get capability you return them. So get capability is something that you override. By the way, this is something that Forge added. It's not Minecraft, it's Forge. And there's a few standard capabilities. For example, capability item handler, item handler capability, and then you return that lazy optional .cast to get the right type. And there's also capability energy, and again you do that. If it's not one of these two, you just return super but get capability. So that's basically what it does. So if another mod wants to examine how much energy is in your block, for example the one probe, it showed, if you saw earlier in demo, it showed how much energy was in the block, it will use this capability, it will ask it from the tile entity, and if it's present, it will use it. For example, I will show you some code to show how that would work. Say you have tile entity, the A is world, but get tile entity position. If tile entity instance of, or not is zero, for example, then you can do the A, but get capability energy, how was it called again? Capability energy, but energy. Optionally, you can give a site, say you want to examine from the upper side. You would see if there is energy capability at the upper side. If you don't specify site, that should work too. That means the internal energy in the machine itself. But if you do it like this, what do you get? You get a lazy optional of capability. And you can then, it's always not null, you are guaranteed that it will return something. You can then do if present handler.receive energy then false. So what does this do? If the block supports the energy capability, it will call this consumer. It will call this will give you the energy storage, and you can then put energy in it. So you can then use the API of that specific capability. Say you want to return something from it, then you can do capability map handler.get energy stored, or else zero energy. So in this here you see if map will be called on the capability, the energy storage that's in that capability. If it's present, it will call handler put get energy stored. But if it's not present, it will call or else. But this can be shortened in this case with this notation, but that's equivalent. So that's how you would use capabilities from another mod. Same for the item handling, by the way. Like that. You can define your own capabilities. In my mods, I do that for various other things. That's fine. The tile entity also has this counter data. So these two and this is actually the data that is stored with the tile entity. Two important functions for tile entities are read and write. These are used whenever the data is synced on the disk. So these are also important things you need to implement. Read, you can call deserialize on these capabilities and you get the inventory and the energy text from them. Here you get the counter integer. Writing is the other way around. You create a serialized item handler, serialized storage, and the counter. You see here that because we use our internal item handler, we don't have to go through the capability system. We know we are in this tile entity. We know we can do it like this. So this is the basic things. By the way, having this capability like this is sufficient. So let's see how this works. Create handler. It creates an item stack handler. This is a method in Forge. It's a very convenient way to make a handler for items, for item stacks. In this case, we only want one slot, that's for the diamonds. This is an important method that you need to override because this writing only happens if the chunk is marked dirty. And that only happens if you call mark dirty on the tile entity. If you don't do that and something changes, then when you quit the game, it is possible that this is not going to be called, this is not going to be saved, and your power or items are lost. So that's every time something changes in the item stack handler, you need to call mark dirty. You see the same, by the way, in the energy thing. If something changed, you need to call it. So this is something that Forge added. This is something that this tutorial adds, by the way. It's just this is standard from Forge, but it adds a set energy. By the way, I'm going to on energy changed. It's slightly better. It also calls mark dirty here. Here you can, in item stack handler, you can override item stack valid so that only diamonds are accepted. And here we check this again. Be careful, you have to do this twice because there's a difference between a hopper will simply call insert item, it will not call is item valid. So there's no guarantee that this is called, so you should always check at both places. If possible, you can of course just call is item valid here, that works just as well. Be careful about the simulate. If this is true, you should do the same as if the item was inserted but not actually inserted. So tick is what is called every tick for this tile entity when it's placed in the world. Remember, again, server client, this is called on both sides, both server and client. And in this case, we're only interested in the server side. So if we are on the client, we return immediately. Because generation of power, everything that is logic should happen on the server. So basically, what do? We have a counter. This is a bit of a timeout. If it's greater than zero, we decrease it. And if it becomes zero, we add energy to our block. So counter should only be greater than zero after we consumed a diamond, and that's what happens here. If the counter is zero or less, we check if we have a diamond there, we extract it, and we set the counter to the number of ticks from the configuration. So more about configuration later. And we call mark dirty to make sure that our changes to counter are saved. So this will produce power if there are diamonds. So every time a diamond is found, it will remove it and set the counter. And when the counter reaches zero again, the energy will be added. We also want to change, you remember, we had the front side that was yellow when it was doing something. That happens here. So we first check if the powered state of our block state is different from what we want. Counter greater than zero means that is powered, and if the powered flag doesn't correspond with that, we need to change it. We also use notify neighbors and block update. So this will cause, you can, by the way, you can click and see what all these flags mean. There's a flags that you can give with this set block state. But basically what this means is that the tile entity will be notified client side as well. So at the block state will be notified client side as well, so that we will actually see the change. What we also do, regardless of this, is if we have power inside our block, we send it out. By the way, 4G energy is normally a push system. That means that you usually don't extract power. Instead, power generators and power cells will push power to the nearby blocks. It's best to always use that approach. And that's what happens here. So we get our total capacity as an atomic integer. That's because we need to be able to modify it. Actually, this is from where I was using capabilities. It doesn't actually have to be. I think this can just be an integer as well in this case. That's slightly. Let's do it like that. Oh no. Yeah, we still have a handler. I was wrong. Okay, it has to be like this. Because inside lambdas, which is this one, you can't simply modify variables outside. You can also do that indirectly by modifying the state of a variable that is outside. So that's why this has to be like this. Atomic integer is a mutable integer, as it were. So if we have a power left, if we have no power left, we don't do anything. Otherwise, we go check on all directions. So we iterate over all possible direction values. This is an enum containing the six directions from a given block. And first we check if there's a tile entity at that direction. So from our current position, which is a variable of the local of our own tile entity, we offset in that direction and we check if there's a tile entity there. So what do we do here? We get the energy capability from that direction, and if present, we call this consumer. And we return true. So this boolean that we return here is an indication if our capacity or power becomes zero, we stop iterating. We don't continue. That's what this do continue is. And that's why this is here. If not do continue becomes false, we simply return. Otherwise, if the handler can receive, that's a method in energy capability, we receive energy based on the minimum of the capacity that we have. That's actually a bug. It should be maximum. So the amount of energy that we get from a near neighbor block is the maximum of our capacity, and the configuration value, that the maximum that we can send out. This was a real bug. Okay, this receive energy returns the actual received energy. We modify our capacity and we actually consume the energy from our energy storage, and we mark 30. So that's how we send out power to all six sites. So this is basically, this explains the tile entity. Then we have the container. So the container is an important class that does the communication between, when you open the GUI, between the client side and the server side. It makes sure that the slots and other information is synced correctly between both sides. So to do that, there's a few standard things that you do. This is a window ID. This corresponds to the actual open window. It's an identifier for the container system. And you get the world, the position, the player inventory, and the player. And so what we do here is, this is a safety check. Normally we should have a tile entity if this is called. But basically what we do here is we add a slot for our diamond slot. So if the item handler is present, we add a slot for index 0. We only have one slot in our inventory, so we only have one index. If you would have more slots, like for a chest for example, you could add more. So this slot will be responsible for the communication between client and server. Actually the container is responsible, but it will happen through this slot. And also for the player inventory, we also add slots here, add slot range, again add slot item handler. So the player inventory also has to be added to this container. What we also want to communicate is the actual power that's inside, because when we open our GUI, there was that power bar that you could see. It's synced automatically between server and client, and that happens here. So the container system from Minecraft has a way to communicate slots, but it also has a way to communicate integers. Unfortunately, even though it says track int and int reference holder, and it has int here and int there, and even though on a single player it will actually work with full integers, on a dedicated server it doesn't, because it's capped to 16 bits. So that means that our 32-bit energy has to be split in two halves. So these are the least significant 16 bits, and these are the most significant 16 bits. So don't be fooled by that. Don't be fooled by int. And here, it's not 32-bit, it only supports 16 bits. Even though it may seem to work correctly, on a server it will not work. So that's why this construct is here, why there are two integers being tracked. They are actually the same integer, but a different part of it. So basically what does this do? It is called every time the energy changes on the server. Every time this integer changes on the server, this track int will notify and it will send it to the client. So that's why there's a get and a set. It should be symmetrical, and that is for communication. This is called by the GUI because, yeah, so when the energy changes on the server and you have a GUI open, the container will make sure that the client-side tile entity, because on the client-side you have an also tile entity instance, the energy value or of the capability inside the tile and the client-side tile entity will not automatically be updated, but the container will make sure that it's updated, and then the GUI can get it from the container using this. So it's important to note that if you have a tile entity, there will be both a server side and a client side version of it, but the client side version is not automatically updated on the client. it's not automatically the same as a server-side entity. You have to keep that in mind, that communication is not automatic there. If you want to sync it for a GUI, the easiest way is using this system. But if it's more complex than just an integer, you will have to use your own networking packages. You also override can interact within your container. So if the player is too far away, is within usable distance, will return false. This is a method from container itself. This is also an important method that you have to implement. It will basically make sure that if the player shift clicks an item on this index, it will move that item to a good spot. And in case of our routine, depends on where the index is. So index is zero means our diamond slot. And then if you shift click on the diamond in the slot of the diamond slot, it will have to go somewhere in the player inventory. That's this range. Otherwise, if it is a diamond, you want to try to merge it in the diamond slot. That's this range. And otherwise, you want to toggle it between the hotbar and the other items. That's what happens here. So this is basically a way to control what happens if you shift click. It's a bit annoying that this has to be done, but it works, and you can just modify it if you want. If it was successful, you return item stack but empty. That means that this, if it was not successful, I mean, that nothing happened. Yeah, the rest is all boilerplate. Then the final block, the final class of this is the GUI. This is a really simple GUI. Resource location is an important thing. It's an identifier for practically anything in Minecraft. It has two components. It has a namespace, which is usually the mod ID, and an actual name. In case of a texture, it will be a path relative to the assets directory, my tutorial. So this will be relative to here, and it will correspond to this. And this is later on used. In the constructor of our GUI, we get the container, which is the important thing that communicates between server and client, and the player inventory. We have a render, where we render our background. We do the actual rendering of the superclass, and we render a tooltip. So that's how this works. We have a foreground and a background layer. So the foreground layer, there we render our energy we get from the container. In the background layer, we render our GUI. And this blit method is what is used to render a texture on screen. So this is a very simple GUI. The container will make sure of communicating the slots so that everything looks correct in game. Okay, so these are the four basic building blocks for this. But of course, just making those classes is not enough. You also have to register it. And what I usually do, there are a few ways you can use to register things. I like to use the deferred registry. And that's also what I will be explaining in this class, in this tutorial. It starts with this call, which you call from the mod constructor, and that basically will call these. So what are registries? This is something that Forge added on top of Minecraft. Basically, practically anything in the game that is of importance has a registry. If you go look at the Forge registries, you see there are registries for blocks, for fluids, for items, potions, biomes, sound events, potion types, and so on. You see there are lots and lots of registries. And you should always, when you make any new, for example, when you make a new block, when you make a new entity type, you should always go through the registry system. That's the only correct way to make new things in Minecraft. You don't have to use the default registry. You can also work with the event system, but I will explain how this works because I think it's a better system. This will actually internally use the event system as well for registration. So in the initialization, you basically register these deferred registers on the mod event bus. That's what happens here. After doing this, these will become usable. And for example, then you can do this. This will register R block. So that means we make a registry object of first block. It's called first block, and we call block.register with the registry name and with a supplier, which in this case simply calls the constructor. And you do the same for item. Note that if you want to be able to hold your block in your inventory, you also need an item, because inventory cannot store blocks, it can only store items or item stacks. And that's why there has to be an item, which usually has the same registry name, and it will use the block as a parameter. It uses block item, which is a specific instance of item. If you go to block item, you see that it extends item. If you want, you can make your own block items if you want to do custom things when the block is placed, for example. But here we use the standard one. And it also gets a property where we set our item group, which is the tab for our the creative tab. It's important to note that the registries, these things are not registered at this time. That happens later. There is a specific order in which things are registered. And for example, blocks are registered before items, because items often need the blocks. So, but you don't have to worry about that. You just declare registry object. This, you might, if you place it like this, it will also work. It doesn't matter. You just have to declare them. The registry system, using events, will make sure it happens in the correct order. We also need a tile entity, and tile entities are done with tile entity type. So it's important to note the things that are here as parameter of the registry object are actually singletons in a way. There's only one first block instance which you register here. There's only one first block item instance. But tile entities, there are multiple instances of a tile entity, because every first block that you place in the world will get its own tile entity. That's why there is a tile entity type, which acts a bit as a constructor for these tile entities. So first, tile entity type. So we have a registry object of tile entity type of our tile entity. And again, it's tiles.register with the name, I use the same name, and a supplier. And there's a standard tile entity type with build.create. This is a standard supplier that you can use, which gets another supplier to create the tile entity, which is just the new of our constructor. And the blocks for which this tile entity is used, and then you build it. And a parameter for data fixing, which is not used here. So this is a construct that you should always use for making new tile entity types. And if you go look at the tile entity itself, the constructor, you see the first parameter is actually the tile entity type, which you get here from the registry. The final thing you need to register is the container. Also, containers have to be registered. And again, there's the container type, because containers also have multiple instances, so you need container type. And again, same principle, you get a supplier. There's a forge container type at create, which gets a factory with three parameters. That's the window ID, the player inventory, and extra data. And this data we use, that's something that forge added, we use to get the position of our tile entity. I will show you later where that is actually given. Actually, I can show you now. If you check here, open GUI. This version, we are using the version that has an extra blog post. And that blog post, if you go look at Open GUI, there's a consumer that will write the blog post on a network packet. So when the GUI is opened on the server side, the container is opened on the server side, a packet is sent to the client so that the client can also open it, and this information is added on top of that packet so that the client in his registration can get that position, and from that can get the tile entity as well. This will only be called on the client side, but that's not really important in this case. So for our first block, these are the four registry objects that we need. And also, by the way, if you go look at the container in the constructor, you will also note that we use our container type as a parameter. So that's basically how this works. In case of the GUI, we also need to do something on the client side. We actually have to tell we have to associate this container with this screen, because if the GUI is opened on the server, packet is sent to the client to open the GUI, then the client needs to know it gets this container. It needs to know what screen to open for it, and that happens in client setup here. So there's a screen manager, register factory. So if you go look at screen manager, it's a Minecraft thing, not a Forge thing. So you register factory, you give the container type, and then again a supplier or a factory in this case to construct the GUI. This will be called, then it will get the containers, player factory and component name, and then this can work. So this is the only thing you actually have to do in client setup in this case, because there has to be a way to connect the container to the screen. So that's basically everything you need to know about this first block, and that concludes the second tutorial in this series. If you have any questions, feel free to ask, of course. In the next episode, we will continue with the other stuff. So see you next time. Bye bye.